Amen. Good morning, Mountain Movers Church. How are you guys this morning? All right, awesome. We are awake this morning. We're ready to go. We're going to have a wonderful time this morning. We have a very, very special, special treat for you guys in store this morning. And this is Back to Church Sunday. It's National Back to Church Sunday. So all over America right now, while we're meeting here, there are churches just from coast to coast that are being flooded with people that have just been called this morning to come back to church and just step foot in the doors and get a dose of God's presence this morning. So it's exciting to know that we're a part of something much, much bigger than ourselves. The church this morning is celebrating getting people back.
That's right. I was going to tell you this week, as Brad and I were talking to a girl who, right out of the chute, we were inviting her to come to church, and she said, "Well, I'm not an atheist." I said, "Well, that's awesome. You know, that's a good thing in a first introduction." And as she was talking to us, we were inviting her, and we said, "Hey, you want to come to our church? It's not like other churches you've probably ever been to." She'd been hurt, you know, and this is an opportunity to come back on a day like this when the walls are not going to cave in. And Brad told her, he said, "You know what's really cool about our church?" He said, "The walls are like 16 foot tall, and they've never caved in." And she was like, "What?" He said, "The walls are not going to cave in. Like, I'm there, and the walls are still standing."
So if I'm there, and the place hasn't fallen apart,
that's right. And so today is an awesome day for anyone and everyone to come back in and experience God for what He really is. God wants to have a real, life-changing relationship with each one of us. And we are so excited that you're here for that.
So this morning, we're going to do something a little bit different than what we normally do. We're going to, because I don't like ordinary, I don't like average, I like routine, but I don't like doing the same thing over and over and over and over again. I like change. So we're going to have some change this morning. What we have for you is we have a panel of people whose lives have been dramatically changed by a real relationship with Jesus. And we want them to share with you what God has done in their life. So if you guys would help me make welcome this morning our three individuals that have been changed by God, give it up for Mr. Will. And we've got Miss Lacey and Mitch. Come on up here.
Come on down.
All right, guys, have a seat.
Before we even get going, I want to tell you how thankful we are for three people who are willing to get up in front of a crowd of people and be transparent about their story. The reason we chose these three individuals is because it's not because they say their lives have been changed. It's not because they tell us that they have a relationship with Jesus. It's because we, as their pastors, have seen their lives completely, totally changed. And we called them out and said, "Hey, we don't want to preach on this day. We want people to hear your incredible stories." So you're going to get to hear real stories from real people today.
All right, so at any time, you guys can just jump in and share, but what I want to start off with this morning is just tell us, what was life like before Christ?
We'll start with you, Mitch.
Go ahead and start, Mitch.
Everybody hear me? Okay, good. My life before God, in a nutshell, was a mess, a wreck. In short, because we ain't got a whole lot of time, I could go on and on and on and tell you how bad it really was. The gist of it is there was alcohol, drugs, lust. I mean, anything you can imagine I dealt with, or I did. So my life without Christ was absolutely miserable. And I went through that whole phase thinking, I'm happy, I'm doing good. You know, I can do this by myself. I don't need anybody. I knew there was something that wasn't there. And as a person who went to church all his life, I knew what that something was, but I did not want to go that route. I didn't want to go there because I never had that life change. I never had that real connection with God. So that came later. So that was me before.
That's
Christ.
Good. So, Lacey, how about you? What was life like before you came into that relationship with Jesus?
Mine kind of follows suit with Mitch's. I kind of experienced some of the same things in my life. I like to go out and party with my friends, hang out with the wrong crowd. And I guess one way you could say that my life before Christ was I wasn't living it on purpose. And with that being said, not living it on purpose, I mean that I was doing things my own way, doing the things that I thought was fun, doing the things I thought was right. But I, as well with Mitch, is I had that big hole, that big gap missing in my life. And I also went to church my whole life and knew that Jesus was real and knew who he was, but I didn't have that connection with him either. And so the things that I did were the things that I wanted to do, the fun that I thought that I was supposed to be having, but I wasn't doing it because I was living for Christ. I was doing it because I was living for myself.
So when you say you were hanging out with the wrong crowd, I mean, be specific. What was it about them that made them the wrong crowd for you?
They were the wrong crowd just because they were drinking, partying, drugs. I didn't necessarily do those things, but those were the things going on around me, and I did partake in some of those activities, not all of them, but those were the ones that were getting in trouble all the time, you know. And it seemed like that there was times in my life where I was in fear of knowing that I was gonna get in trouble, you know, but it didn't change my mind. I still hung around with those people knowing that at any moment we could get caught excuse me, doing the things that we were doing and get in trouble for them.
And the Bible says bad morals corrupts good character. So even though, you know, you say you may not have been involved in some of those things, what we have to realize is that we're being contaminated, right, with the influence of others around us on a continual basis.
And later on in life, it did influence.
Catch up with you.
Yep.
Yeah, absolutely. I guarantee it. So Will, how did you really feel deep down? Like, what was going on? What was the condition of your heart before you came to Christ? What was it really like?
Well, when I was growing up, it was like there was really not a lot of love in my house. I grew up in an extremely abusive home, learned that response, and as I grew up, I wanted to inflict pain on people. I inflicted pain on myself. It was the drugs, the alcohol. My younger brother was following my footsteps. I was the leader. We ended up getting involved in small town gangs, and by the time my brother was 14, was initiated into Crips. So we both grew up just a solid rock hard. Had no care for anybody, no passion for nothing. If we wanted it, we took it. Or if somebody wanted it from us, they took it, and we had to fight. And like I said, there was no real guidance at all. There was just so much fight and blood and just hatred. I mean, we'd walk the streets, and if we seen somebody on the other side of the street, and we just didn't like what shirt they had on, we would cross the street, and there'd be three or four or five of us just beat this guy down. We just didn't care. And I mean, you know, without God at all, there was absolutely nothing. I mean, it was just completely black. You just don't care about nothing, including your own life. And I even grew up to a point to where anxieties and depression, suicide, I couldn't tell you how many times that, you know, suicidal thoughts, to the point where I was right there. There was just nothing that I wouldn't do. Metal pipes, poles, hammers, whatever it took. If I got angry and I didn't want to hurt somebody, I had to control that. I didn't know how. The only way I knew how was when I got in trouble when I was younger, I got beat. So I did it myself. Wow. I would go off and hide somewhere and just beat me down myself. Wow. Just to keep from inflicting pain on somebody.
Wow, amazing. That's amazing.
With each of you, your story, though different, is very similar, which is where we all were before Christ. And even though the exact situation might have been different, the home life might have been different, where you grew up might have been different, the point is that without Christ, deep down, just like Will said, we're just black. We are miserable. And even though we will convince ourselves, as you guys said, that you're happy, because you're doing what you want to do, and especially as a young kid growing up, then into your teenage years, into young adulthood, what do you always want? You always want freedom. Because it's like your parents are always putting their thumb on you and telling you what you can and can't do. And so often what we do is we kind of take our own path and that's what you guys are explaining to us. So tell us, what was like the turning point? What turned you and made you realize, was there just a moment in time that you realized, that you recognized you needed Jesus? Did you realize that's what you needed? What was that moment for you? What was that turning point in your life? Go ahead, Mitch.
I think God gave me several opportunities to do that, as he does everybody on a daily basis. You know, I don't think living for Christ is just, you know, you get saved once and then you're good till you die. It's not like that. For me, it's an everyday, you know, I don't want to say struggle. It's not a struggle. It's an everyday practice, if you will.
Yeah.
And practice makes perfect. I strive to have a connection with God every single day.
That's a good way to look at it. That's good.
But he's gave me very many chances to have that relationship. You know, and there's several eye-openers I had. I mean, I used to drink a lot. And when I say a lot, I mean a lot.
How much?
What's a lot?
A couple cases in a weekend. I mean, that's a lot for me. I don't know. If anybody's drinking any more than that, stop. That's a lot.
That is good advice,
that is,
man.
That's a lot.
Anyway.
That's a lot.
But there have been several instances where I drink, and then I just take off into the wilderness. Or, you know, one time I walked down the street, and I was hitchhiking, I guess, because I was mad about something. And a guy picked me up, and we rode around drinking together for like 3 hours. I don't know who he was.
So you got
out of your head,
you became more drunk with an individual that you didn't know,
right?
Just driving around in his vehicle.
He could have been like a murderer or something, and I wouldn't have known. You know what I mean? I could have died right then,
right,
or something, or gotten a car wreck with this guy or whatever.
That was just one instance. That's nuts, man.
The thing that turned me around was this. Me and my wife at the time was attending church, but I wasn't. I was doing what I'd done when I was a teenager. I would go and I would sit there and wouldn't get anything out of it. I would not have that connection with God, and then I'd leave. I would not take anything with me, because it's not just here that we do church. We do church at our home. You know what I mean? That's where it counts.
At work. Yeah.
But anyway, we had a fight. And I was like, I'm going to the bar, because that's the place I need to be, right? So I went to the bar, and I got absolutely...
That was your go-to place.
Right, yeah.
That was your escape.
Yeah, that's where all my problems, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. But so I went to the bar, and I got really, 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 really drunk, and decided I was going to just take off driving somewhere. And I don't really remember even leaving the bar. What I do remember is, I remember opening my eyes just a little bit, and I seen lights, and I heard a on my window, and the cop opened my door, and I was laid back with my seat all the way back, and this is what the cops told me. They said that I was on the very top of the crest of this hill, and it was a very steep hill. And at the bottom of the hill, the road teed. There was nothing there, fence and trees, as if. And so I'm at the top of this hill, and I've got the truck in drive with my foot on the brake, truck running, and me asleep. Now, the only explanation that I can come up with is that was God. Even in my darkest moment, even in the time where I did not deserve anything at that moment, totally defying God and everything he stood for, he said, I'm going to spare you because I've got better things for you. So that really opened my eyes right there to what God has for me, and I began to really seek out who God is. And it's still every day, you know, you strive to get closer and closer. Some days I fail miserably. Some days, you know, are better than others. But every day I try to have a connection with God at some point.
And that's really the key. When you say it's about a connection with God, it's not just about going to church. Church is not the cure-all. Church is, like I remember, Lacey, one time you told a group of teenagers, church is like a workshop. It's where we go and we learn and we get pumped up. But church, honestly, is us 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. We are the church. And you may or may not know that Mitch is my nephew. And when... Whatever.
Don't claim it.
It doesn't claim me, I guess. But I remember when Mitch was in that point of running from God, that Brad and I would pray for him and all of his family. We were constantly praying for him, and he didn't always want to come around because, you know, when you're not really living the way that you know you ought to be living when you've grown up in it, you kind of shy away from the people who are. And so, man, we were praying for him, and I remember one night I was asleep and I had a dream. And I know that this dream was not just any dream. It was a dream from God. And in that dream, Mitch was in the middle of that dream, and Mitch was driving drunk, and he got in an accident, and God took his life. And I remember waking up knowing Mitch would burn in hell. And I got up, and I remember praying and crying and telling Brad, I'm like, we have got to get that boy in church. He's going to get killed behind the wheel of a car. He's going to get killed, and he's going to go to hell for the rest of eternity. And I'll never forget when that accident happened. Man, as we were praying, it was only because of the hand of God, because what had happened in my dream did come to pass, except for God intervened.
It was a warning, a call to prayer.
And what's amazing about that is think about the love of Almighty God. Think about the fact that regardless of what he was doing and where he was, God loved him so much that he wanted to just shake him at his core. But it was about that connection that you never had. All right, Miss Lacey, tell us, for you, was there like a turning point? What was it that got you into the house of God and connected in that relationship?
There's always been things in my life, too, that I can see God's hand on my life, even when I didn't deserve it. And there's several instances, maybe not quite as extreme as Mitch's, but there's times in my life where I was doing things that I never should have been. In cars with people who were drinking and driving. So I guess it's, you know, I wasn't the one who's drunk driving, but it's all stupid. you make the decision to get in a car with somebody who's been drinking, you're automatically putting your life into jeopardy. And, you know, that was when I was a teenager out running around carefree, you know, thinking that I was on top of the world but didn't have Christ in my life at that point. And, like I said a while ago, I just continued my life living for me. And I would say the turning point in my life would have been after I had my kids. Actually, I take that back. I was pregnant with my first daughter and realized that, you know, I had that big void in my life and that I needed something. And you know, Brett and Misty had started the church here, and my husband had talked me into coming here and going to church, I'd come to church, but I would leave kind of like Mitch did. You know, I wouldn't take anything with me. I wouldn't leave with anything. I just knew growing up that you went to church, you listened to the preacher, and you left. You know, I didn't know how to have that relationship with Christ, but I remember being in the kids' church area where we had church at that time, and I would see people at the altar and people raising their hands, and I would think to myself, you know, how do I get that? I want that. I want that connection. I'd see them at the altar with tears just running down, and I'm like, well, what is that all about? You know, because I didn't have that relationship. I didn't know how to get connected with Christ. And so I just continued to seek further and further and further until, you know, I gave my life to Christ and started serving him every day and was fulfilled by his presence.
Okay, so just to shift directions for a second, how did serving change or impact your walk with God? Because I know that was a big turning point. You just kind of touched on it. But when you started serving, I mean, it really started to click in your life. Things changed.
Like serving in the church?
Yeah, serving in the church.
Yes. When I started serving in the church, God started laying things on my heart, and I was never really one to get up in front of a crowd and speak or do anything, but God continuously started laying the youth and the teenagers on my heart, and I got just or had a burning desire to want to speak to them and reach them, and and to just speak into their life, because I remember all the time I would hear, if I would have known then what I know now,
right?
Knowing that my teenage life was not the best. That's kind of when most of my trouble life was. And at that point, God, when I was serving, you know, I was stepping into the house of God more often. I was here every time the doors were open because I had the opportunity to serve Christ in this church. And when I started serving, that's when God really started laying his calling onto my life, in the direction he wanted me to go. And so my first time with the youth was Brad let me come in and speak with his group that he had, and I remember I was so nervous. But you know, when God calls you, my favorite thing is that God doesn't call the equipped, he equips the called. And so that's when I knew I needed to step out of my box and just let God take control.
Yeah, that's awesome. Powerful. Thank you for sharing that. So, Will, now Misty and I know this story because we've been able to witness, you know, you really coming back to Christ and coming back to church. And it's a great story. I can't wait for you guys to hear this. So tell us, what was the turning point? What was life like? And what caused you to get back into God's house and get back into that real and life-changing relationship?
Well, I had, you know, it's funny how God works. If you're not going to pay attention to him, he'll start trying to get your attention.
It's well said. Well said.
You know, and I had several points in my life where he was trying to get that attention to me. And there was three parts to this. The first time, and in fact, it was only about 3 years ago that I just completely lost it. I had a neck surgery. I had been on Percocets for like 9 months. And I was done. And I quit the Percocets cold turkey. It flipped my lid. I was just completely out of control. And somebody would say just the smallest thing, and I would just explode. And one day I exploded, up to this point, had put my kids, my wife, my mom, everybody through a living hell going through this stuff. I was so upset that I just took my truck, put it in gear, stomped the gas, and rammed a tree. Just done. And at that point, it was like, you know, the wife coming out, my mom was on the phone with her. It was like, okay, you're about to lose everything that I have given you so far. Straighten up. And that was just a small voice.
It's God's warning. Yeah.
And so I ended up going to a mental hospital, getting the help that I was trying to, you know, searching for. And they got everything kind of balanced out with, you know, medications and counseling and things like that. Then, you know, we went on for a little bit. Sorry. But we went on for a little bit and started getting selfish. You know, yeah, okay, everything was starting to work out at home. Everything was kind of coming back together. But the kids were still nervous about how I was acting and all this. And then we find out I have to go through a second neck surgery. And here comes the whole discussion about pain pills. And then I'm sure the kids were going, oh, my God.
You're right. He's coming back.
So when I talked to the doctor, I told him, I just want enough just to take the edge off. I do not want to relive all that I put my family through. So that's what we're going on. I'm going 4 months now with a neck surgery, and I have not been able to go back to work. And we're living by the grace of God, and I'm telling you, it happens every day for us. But the big turning point was there was so much selfishness in me. I mean, I was taking care of my home. I was taking care of my family. I was providing the finances that we needed to do things. But I would go off and do my own thing. And it was just completely destroying my marriage. And my wife, caught me committing adultery. basically at that point, my family was destroyed. Complete selfishness. You know, I was out to get what I wanted, satisfy myself, and just destroyed everything that God's given me that, you know, I had worked hard for. And at that point, my wife and my kids were going here to church. I had my oldest boy. He would come back a couple, you know, 2-3 weeks when you guys were having the whole I don't know what you call it, episode or
a series.
Series, yeah.
It's okay. I can't remember what they are either.
Yeah, on the missing link. And
which was a call, calling men to authentic manhood, calling the spiritual champions out of men to be the fathers and leaders of their home and husbands.
And
good.
And Bradley, my oldest, he'd come back, you know, on the Sunday, and he would sit and he would talk to me about it. He was really wanting that manly figure in home.
Wow.
That's a bold teenager to come home and talk to the
father.
That's
an awesome teenager.
That is
to
awesome.
Have that godly figure at home. You know, the dad, the father, to guide him, you know, in God's way. And I wasn't there. I didn't have none of that. You know, I didn't really care for it. I had decisions in my life and things that I seen in my life that I didn't care for church. I knew God. I just knew of him. Didn't really have that desire. Well, when we ended up facing this, and I was caught with all that, my wife, that was on a Saturday. Then, of course, you know, with the kids and stuff like that, we just kind of kept it kind of quiet. I slept on the couch. And right then is when I started hearing this voice. Wife and kids got up, went to church, and I kept having this voice tell me that I needed to go. But I just could not bring myself to do it. Because I felt after everything that we went through that Saturday night, that they would think that I was just getting up for a show. You know, I was just doing it just to, you know, because of the cold-heartedness that I had, that just to try to cover up, make things sugar-coated again, everything will be okay, you know, just, it'll be all right. Well, through that whole time between Bradley and talking about the missing link and stuff, I just, you know, sometimes subtle hints don't work. And
God has to get the bigger hammer.
God has,
you know, sometimes you have your
bigger hammers for more stubborn people.
Where you're trying to talk to them and they just will not listen. You feel like just going up behind them and popping them in the back of the head. I really felt that day God used both hands. Because
both sides of the head.
There was this huge conviction when they left. I watched bits and pieces to kind of skim through the last part of the series on Missing Link. Then all I could do was, it was just weighed so heavy on just reading what the Bible had to say about adultery. And, you know, I was, between growing up and to this point, I was on the train. I was the engineer headed to hell. And I can't explain the conviction that I set in that yard. That Sunday. But when he's ready for you, and he's tired of trying to give you a hint to go, he's going to get your attention. And when he did it, he lit the fire under my butt. And
I got up and did nothing but run. We're just a couple months of me rededicating my life, but there is absolutely nothing that stands in my way of this. I wake up every morning. I'm in the Word. TV, I'll flip through and try to find me a Christian station so I can hear the Word. If I'm busy and I know that I need the Scriptures, I have that app where I can have the Bible read to me.
YouVersion.
Yeah. And, once I got into this, God has done nothing but show me everything I need to do. And as long as you listen, things will come to pass. Family life couldn't be any better. Marriage, just building back up. Something like that that would destroy a marriage, it takes some work. It's not easy, especially after, somebody messes up as bad as they did. So, but God has placed my wife, that is just amazing, has placed her in my life for a purpose. Now, I'll probably take up a lot of time, but, He put a very, very strong woman in my life.
Yes, he did.
And
those of you guys who know his wife.
Everybody will say, behind a great man is a greater woman. And sometimes she has a pan in her hand.
So if it's not God's hand, it's your wife.
That's why I like her so much.
Yeah.
It all makes sense now.
And without all that, and then on top of it, having great kids that are willing to make sacrifices themselves, especially through the struggles that we have, and making them realize that this is a family, and just like church, coming here every Sunday and every Wednesday, it's not just you come in the doors, hey, how you doing, listen to the preaching and leave. This is a family, and if you struggle, and if you have a problem, this is where you go, to family. They're here to help, pick you up, comfort you, whatever you need. Sometimes you can find that by reading the Bible on your own. You can hear God talk to you. But in the Bible it says where two or more are gathered together, that's my church. So when we all gather here, it's to
we become the church.
Yes,
we are the church.
And
it's not just a building.
It's just like a marriage. We all become one. We are here to help each other. Nobody is going to fall down without somebody else picking them up.
That's awesome.
That's right. And the thing that we strive to be at Mountain Movers is transparent, and it's not easy. If you want to be the next one, you come and let us know. But I promise, it's not easy to get up in front of a crowd and to tell your background and your past.
Yeah.
The reason that we share transparency is because we want to show what Jesus can really do. These are lives that are completely, radically changed. You may or may not know that Lacey and Mitch, they team up to head up Accelerate, which is our teen ministry. And if you're a teenager in this place, you should be yelling right now, because they do a phenomenal job. And what's amazing is they know what teenagers face because they've already went through it. They know exactly what teenagers are thinking because they've already lived it. And yet they're young enough and they're transparent enough to say, hey, I wasn't perfect, but God reached out his hand of mercy on my life. And if I can turn over and connect with God, you can too. We quickly, as we're winding down here, tell us, what are the number one, two, and three, like the top three habits that you do on a regular basis to stay connected with God? Because like you said, Mitch, it's an everyday connection. It's not just once a week going to church. And I kind of like to put it this way. I remember telling you this one time. Do you just eat once a week? You're like, no. I'm like, well, try just doing that. And if you think about the spiritual food, God's word and the prayer in the house of God, you need it every day, just like you need physical food in your mouth for your body. So tell us, what are the habits you guys have established? We'll kind of touch on a little bit, but that you do every day to stay connected with God.
One of the main things is I pray with my family every day. Individually and sometimes all together. Just
that deserves
on what we're doing.
A round of applause.
That's awesome. But
man of God praying with his family.
In my opinion, it is very, very important that not only my wife, but my kids have a Jesus moment sometime in the day. And if it, you know, I want to make sure if they haven't got it, that, you know, I help them.
And tell us, how old are your kids?
4 and 1.
One not born yet. Coming in a couple days.
One coming in a couple days.
Yeah.
So
Tuesday.
The reason I wanted to point that out is Mitch is saying that it's important that his children at the age of 4, 1, and not even born have a Jesus moment every day. Because age doesn't make a difference.
The youngest one is not born yet, of course, but I pray for him. We pray for him every day, even now. And he's not even here yet. And if you don't know that, just a quick, he's an adopted baby, which God has also blessed us in that area. We was not able to have children, so we have 2 foster kids and 1 baby that God just laid in our lap and said, here you go.
And that just confirms, validates
right. The
favor of God. When you put Christ at the very center of your life,
right. He
begins to bless your life and gives you what you need.
There's tons of stuff God's done for us, but I can't explain them all right now because we don't have time. But that's one. Prayer with my family is a must. Reading my Bible. You know, as believers, we need to get in our Word. And I'm going to be honest with you and tell you, I don't read my Bible every day.
Would you recommend that for everybody else?
Yes. Do it.
That's a growing problem.
No, I mean, yes, I strive to do it every day. And I get a
it
scripture. I get a scripture every day. I'll put it that way. There's a scripture I read every day. But I don't open my Bible every day because I get busy, and you know we all do that. But strive to do that. That's a must for me as well. Other than that, just have a Jesus moment.
What role?
What I mean by that is pray until you feel Jesus.
Yeah, that's good advice.
Do that. Be intimate with God.
Good. Okay. Just real quick, what impact has just making the habit of being in church and being in God's house every week had on your life?
How much time we got? No, it's ridiculous, honestly. If people don't get this, people can't wrap their mind around what and who God is. If you honestly devote your life to God, I don't even know how to explain it. Okay, the other day, we were just running short on money, and Lindsay called me. She's like, hey,
have any money.
We got like...
Wait a second.
Wait.
That is not how she sounds.
Hey,
you like dropped your voice.
Okay, wait. Okay, I'll redo it.
You made it sound like she's larger than you are.
You're going to have to go way
anyway,
high pitch.
Pick
anyway.
Up some eggs and milk
Anywho.
From the store on the way home.
Anywho, she calls me. She's like, hey, we ain't got no money in the bank. I don't know what we're going to do. And I'm like, okay, you know what, God? I'm sick of it. You can take care of it. I'm not even going to worry about it. I was at work. I'm like, what am I going to do at work anyway? Right? So anyway, it was not an hour.
Not work, right?
Went 1 hour later, she calls me. She's like, hey, did you deposit some money in our bank account? I'm like, no. She's like, oh, well, there's $300 in there that just kind of.
You're kidding me.
That's how God works.
I was like, wait, are you
That's
sure?
Awesome.
So I get up there. I'm all checking it. I got, you know, online banking. I'm like, well, thanks, God. You know, and I just kept on working. It's stuff like that all the time.
That's good.
We've been blessed financially, like, it's ridiculous.
Yeah.
But it's all God.
It is all God. That's great, man.
And the Bible says
love
that
it.
The favor of God goes before the righteous as a shield. And what that literally means is righteousness is being in the right position with God. If there's a storm outside, you want an umbrella over your head. You want to be in the right position, connecting intimately with God. And when you do that, God promises to meet all of your needs, not all your wants, but all your needs. That is an awesome, and these guys could tell you story after story. Miss Lacey, tell us, what are some of the habits that you have established to keep that awesome connection with God?
Well, one thing that Mitch didn't already cover, I definitely try to strive to read my Bible every day as well, just because I know that when I don't, my day doesn't go quite as well as if I start my day in the Word. Because, you know, if you don't start off on the right foot, which the right foot is God, because he's know, who we need in our life, who we need to put first every day of our life. Things just, they don't line out. You know, you got to put Him first in everything you do. And there's mornings, like I have the YouVersion app as well that reads to me. And there's days I just pull my iPad over, hit play, and just lay in bed, you know, those few extra minutes, and just listen to my word and get fed that way. But the other thing I do is I try to make sure that I listen to Christian music more often than not.
That's,
I mean, there is some music that I listen to, you know, otherwise, but I make sure that the message that's being portrayed in those songs is nothing that will affect my life, because I don't want junk and garbage being brought into my life that will influence me. So I try to make sure that, you know, Christian music plays most generally when I'm in the car or at home. And
that's good.
And it impacts my life a lot different. It just brings your spirit up and encourages you more.
And for you, Miss Lacey, how has church, I mean, you talked about serving, so you obviously, you serve in the church, so you are here every time the doors are open. How do you think that keeps you connected?
Well, you know, when you're in the house of God, it's, you get refueled. I mean, you can definitely have church at your own home with your own family, and you should. But when you're gathered in God's house with God's people and fellowship, yes, with one another, and grow your relationships, you just continue to connect with God in a new way. And like Will had said earlier, if you do fall, your church family is here to pick you up no matter what. And you can rely on your church family. You can send a text or a message or a phone call and be like, hey, I'm having a bad day, can you pray for me? You know, it's just someplace where you can go and confide in people who love you and know that they're there for you, and to build each other up in their relationship with Christ.
Amen. That is awesome.
That's good.
As we are coming down to the wire, we have like a couple minutes. So this is going to be a really, you're going to want to stay on for the next, because who knows, they might tell you something different in the next service. But Will, we brought in a bench down here at the very end a few minutes ago, and this is a bench that Will built. And in just a couple minutes, which I know the story is much longer, okay, than a couple minutes, and we're going to do a video with Will so that you can get the whole story. But tell us in a couple minutes, what is this bench, Will, and what does it mean to you? Why did you do this? Will has an awesome talent for wood carving and wood building. You can see another
one
in my
office. He's an
artist.
He's a poet. It's cool.
Amazing. We told you guys a couple weeks ago, we came into our office and there was a bench that was crafted, like in the top it said, greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. You'll have to see it, although my office is messy on a big day like today. But it's in there. But then he came to us and he said, I got this cherry tree. I'm doing a project. I want to do another bench. Tell us, Will, what does this stand for?
All right. Since I got married and met Tammy, which we've been together 13 years, me and her mom have a problem seeing eye to eye. And it's not just because she's short. It's just because we just cannot get along. We hadn't ever been able to get along.
That is awesome.
But, I mean, we would fight all the time. She would make me mad. And one time we were in Joplin, you know, I got so mad, I just, forget about it. I walked from Joplin all the way back home. And
for those of you guys watching online, it's about a 35-minute
drive
by car.
A half a day walk.
By walk, we're talking half a day, right?
Oh, well, yeah. Well, at least, you know, 5 hours.
Okay,
you know,
well, you probably have a more specific time than
but,
I do.
Then you know, she'd come to the house, start trying to be boss there, and here I go, I blow my fuse, and I've seen her home crying. When I rededicated my life, there was a complete change. I like I said, I cannot explain it. It's like, you know, your hands are covered in mud, and you run them under the water. They just wash away.
That's good. Good way to look at
it. She started calling. She started texting me, inviting me over to the house, which was very rare that ever happened.
You're like, wonder if she's trying to poison me.
Yeah. you taste it first. Anyway, the very first project that when we got to, I'd say, reuniting the family is what I call it. The very first project was, she had almost a 40-foot cherry tree in her yard that she wanted to cut down. So as a family, we're all out there, and I'm squirreling up a tree with a chainsaw strapped to my hip.
That's scary.
And cutting down this thing in sections. I asked for the wood. They gave me all the wood there was. This is from that cherry tree.
It's beautiful.
Now, I don't know if I can move around or not, but anyway, I'm going to try. This thing here was the very first project we had. Now, here's what it means to me. When I rededicated my life, God washed away all the aggravation, anger, hatred, regret, resentment that came between me and my mother-in-law. And the whole family got together. I've spent Christmases and Thanksgiving at home alone because I wasn't allowed to go over there. I didn't want to go over there, whatever. So this is built out of that cherry tree. And what it is to me is that this is a place to sit. Family problem, come sit with me. We'll get this worked out. You know, we won't break up. This will reunite. If there's a problem, an argument, whatever, sit with me and let's reunite.
Togetherness.
And that's what that means to me. And I built this thing, and for some reason it's been laid on my heart that we need to do a little bit more for the church. I just feel like I have to. I mean, it's just constantly. It's like I'm getting kicked in the butt every time I walk around. This thing here is built. And what I'd like to do is I feel that it's got to go on for 2 weeks, but we're going to have a silent auction. And with the silent auction, Misty, I'm sure, will get all the other stuff. I got this. She can probably hang on to the rest. But 2 weeks, silent auction, the winner gets this. The money from this goes into the building fund for the church. So, you know, reunite families, keep families together. The bigger this church gets, the more room we have, the more chances we have to fill it.
That's good.
So
well said.
That's what the purpose of this is.
Beautiful, beautiful piece of furniture. I love this. This is like Branson.
Brad was trying to take it home. I was
Branson
like, no,
furniture.
We'll
I'm
already
like,
made
let's
you one.
Let's take it.
You can't
it's
take
amazing.
That one.
I love it. I love it. I love
that's
it.
Awesome.
So I love the vision behind it, and we are going to make this available. What we're going to do today is we're going to set it outside, and actually what we want to do, we have an idea, and I think this will really push this out and give us an opportunity to really raise some good money for this expansion project. For those of you guys who may not know, we are building. We're adding on to this place because we have got to have more room to change more lives. So what we want to do with your blessing is we would like to have a donation drawing, okay? And we have tickets available for you. This will be outside after the second service, and you guys can come and get tickets. Do we know how much the tickets are yet that have been?
The tickets are going to be $1 a donation, which you'll get into the drawing, or 7 for $5. We're going to run it until November 1st. November 1st is a Sunday. All the kids, just like you guys do all the awesome school fundraising, and you guys are amazing. One of my daughters raised $200 in 7 days for the band, and I think if you can do that, you can do this. And so the kids, we're going to have a competition between all of the kids, and there's going to be cash prizes for those of you who can go out and earn. But what we're going to do is you guys are going to get to sell donation tickets on this, and then on November 1st on a Sunday morning we'll draw to give this away
to all see right? who the winner is
going
to
be. And we think because by doing it that way we'll probably raise even more, because Will took so I don't even how much time did this take you? I can't even imagine.
Actually it's
okay, don't tell
really
me then
t-
never
yeah,
mind because when I look at it I'm thinking
it
that took a long
don't
time
don't ask
okay,
a talented
it was
man
probably,
how long it took him
all right.
Well it was probably 10 hours but it was
that's
it
a
was
lot.
I never moved.
That
I
is
mean,
still
I,
amazing.
I constantly worked on it.
Man, I love it.
Almost a solid 10 hours.
I love
well,
it.
I will tell
hours,
you that Mitch was in there, like, looking it over. He was like, dude, I got to build one of these. I'm like, yeah, it's awesome.
Go cut you down a
so
cherry
tree. So that's going to be outside today. But will you guys give these, our panel today, a round of applause? Did they not do amazing? They did amazing.
So as we conclude today, we want to just we want to pray with you, and we want to encourage you, because what God has done in their lives, you know, you might be sitting in this sanctuary right now and you might say to yourself, I'm just like I'm just like they were. You know, I can really relate to what they're talking about. And if that's the case, I want to tell you that God's not, he's not through with you. He's just getting started. And God loves you, and he is the God of many, many, many chances. And maybe today was a day where God just intentionally brought you to this place so that you could hear this message being brought to you by these individuals whose lives have been changed in a real way. We're going to pray with you guys today, and you know, if you already have a relationship with God, I hope that this inspired you and encouraged you to want to go deeper in the things of God and to draw closer to him in a real and life-changing relationship. So if you would you stand with me today? We just want to pray over you. And I'm going to do two things. I'm going to basically give you an opportunity to draw closer to God in your relationship with him, no matter where you're at. But the second thing I'm going to do is I'm going to offer for you, I'm going to extend to you an invitation to have something real with God. Not just an understanding of who God is, not just a knowledge of God, but I'm going to offer you the opportunity in just a moment to make your eternity, that's right, I said eternity, secure. This life is not our eternal place of rest. This earth is not our home. Heaven is our home for those who have that real and life-changing relationship with Jesus. And I want to give you that opportunity in here a moment. If you would, bow your heads with me. And I just want to talk to you. No matter where you're at right now in your walk with God, you might have a great relationship with God. But my question for you is, do you want more? Do you want something deeper? Do you want to go further? Do you want the love of God in your life to be stronger and stronger and stronger? Do you want to experience him in a way that you've never experienced him before? Maybe you have a relationship with God, but you'd say, Pastor Brad, I'm not satisfied. I want more. I want more of what God has for my life. I want his dreams for my life to begin to unfold. There's so many things in my heart that are just undone, and there's so many things in life that I want to experience before I go. And I want God to move in my life in a real and amazing way. I want more of God's plan for my life, and I want to just experience him like never before. If that's you, if you're a believer and you want that in your life, just between you, me, and God this morning, I just want to see your hand. Would you raise your hand this morning? And I just want to pray for you. You want a deeper relationship with God. Even though you know him, you want more. You want him to mature your faith. Amen. Hands all over the room. Thank you, Lord, for these who have been honest this morning. Thank you. I want to pray for you right now. Father, in Jesus' name, you know the heart. You know the thoughts. You know where each and every one of us are at. And I pray, God, that right now you would just take us to that place where you need us to be. I pray that you would lead us, that you would draw us to that place where you need us to be as believers, Father God. Mature us in the faith. Strengthen us to know you more. Help us in our faith to be contagious. That the glory of God that is in our lives, that it would just be overflowing. That it would just get on people that are around us, and they would just see how real you are through us. Do that in our lives. God, I pray that you would make families stronger. I pray that you would bless homes, Father God, to be hungry for your presence, to have a heart for the lost. Pray this in Jesus' name. With heads bowed and eyes closed this morning, I want to offer a second invitation to those of you that would say, Pastor Brad, I know that God exists. I know he's real. I know about him. But I don't have what you've been talking about. I know that if I was to die right now, I know that heaven would not be my home. because I don't have a real and life-changing relationship with Him. What I have is just, it's not been real. And this morning, you say, I want to secure my salvation in Him. I want my life to mean something. I want heaven as my home. I want what those people we're talking about on this panel today, I want to experience what they've experienced. I want to be happy, and I know that that only comes from having Christ in my life. If that's you today, I want to pray with you, and I'm going to count to three, and as I do, when I say three, if that's you this morning, I want you to lift your hand up really high so I can see who you are, so I can pray with you this morning right where you're at. Are you ready? Here we go. This is life change right here. This is your moment. This is your time for your life, real life, for you to discover life like never before. This is it. One, two, three. Raise your hand now. Amen. 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 Anybody else this morning? Come on, you say, I want real life change. I see you in the very back. Amen. Anybody else this morning? Come on, you say, I need God. I need Him to do a work in my life. I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired. And I know that God is the answer. I know that His Son is the answer in my life. Is that you this morning? Raise your hand so I can see you. Amen. 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 Thank you, Lord. I see your hand. Thank you for being obedient. Thank you, Lord, for all of these that have given their life to you this morning. I want to pray with you. Would you agree with me? And let's all of us as the house of God, let's join in together to show our support for these that have made this decision. Father God, I love you. I thank you for your Son, Jesus. I know that there's things I've done. I've displeased you in many ways. I know that I have separated myself from you. And I want you in my life. Forgive me, Lord, of my sins. Cleanse my heart. Make my slate clean. I believe that Jesus is the only way to heaven. I confess Him as Lord of my life. I dedicate from this moment forward that I will live for Him according to His word. I pray this in Jesus' name. Everybody said real loud, amen. Give God praise this morning.
Hey, thanks so much for joining us today. If you want to be a part of something bigger than yourself, give to our ministry. We've made giving easy here at Mountain Movers Church. If you have your smartphone, just text the number 918-223-8090. Just push in the amount you want to give and push send. It's that easy. If you don't have your smartphone, not a problem. You can mail your giving just as easy to 24,000 South 660 Road, Grove, Oklahoma, 74344. Thanks for watching today. Hey, remember, we're dreaming big for you. We'll see you next week.